This is the circuit board of a Megmeet outdoor mini split air conditioner, and I will share its repair tips with you. So whenever you check a PCB, especially when you're on site, make sure to check the main voltages coming in. This way, if there's any voltage issue, it can be fixed right there. After this, when you move to the PCB, first check the brown wire that comes in with the fuse. There should be 220 or 240 volts here. If, for any reason, voltages are coming in on one side, but not on the other, it means the fuse is blown and needs to be replaced. Replacing this fuse could potentially solve the problem. Next, check the two ZNRs here. These are high voltage protection devices. If voltages exceed 250 volts, these will short circuit, causing the fuse or the breaker in the main supply to trip repeatedly, but the rest of the PCB will remain protected. Then, there are surge protection devices installed here. These are designed to handle voltages that come in for milliseconds or seconds, and if the voltage spikes too high, these devices absorb the excess voltage and transfer it to the earth. So if earthing is properly done with the unit, it's ideal as it extends the lifespan of your unit. If any problem arises, excessive spikes will be grounded. After this, there is a line filter that suppresses or filters out unwanted electrical noise. And next to it are two capacitors that handle surge voltages. Then, there's another capacitor used for filtering. Following that, another slightly larger line filter is used to suppress remaining transients from the power supply. And again, two capacitors are installed for filtering purposes. Next, there are two components installed here, a PTC sensor and a relay. Let me first explain the purpose of the PTC sensor. The voltage passes through the PTC sensor before reaching rectification, and the relay switches on afterward. The PTC sensor is installed for protection. If the voltage rises too high, or if there is any issue with the unit, the resistance of the PTC sensor increases significantly. This high resistance reduces the flow of voltage, which causes the unit to shut down, thereby protecting the rest of the system. The PTC sensor may either burn out or temporarily move to high resistance. After the voltage passes through the PTC sensor, it goes into rectification. You will notice two pins here, where the voltage should be 220 or 230 volts. At this point, the voltage is rectified and converted from AC to DC, and we should get 320 volts. After this conversion, the voltage travels through the wire and enters the reactor. The reactor stores energy in the form of a magnetic field when DC current passes through it. When the load demands current, or when the DC voltage drops, the reactor releases this stored energy, which helps maintain a more stable and smooth DC supply. Next, there's a resistor. This is a 10 milliohms resistor used for overcurrent protection. If for any reason current increases more than the required capacity, then this resistor acts as a fuse and blows itself to save the rest of the circuit. Alongside it, there's a small capacitor that controls minor spikes. From here, the voltage moves to the IGBT. The IGBT has three pins: the emitter, collector, and gate. The emitter is connected to the negative terminal, which is typically ground or 0 volts. The collector is linked to the positive terminal of the DC supply, often labeled as positive. The gate serves as the control terminal. When a positive voltage is applied to it relative to the emitter, the IGBT is turned on, allowing current to flow from the collector to the emitter. When the emitter and collector come into contact, the reactor becomes electromagnetically charged, and then the IGBT turns off. Afterward, the reactor has to release the stored energy, which flows through the diode, into the capacitor. After this, there is a diode, and this type of diode is often referred to as a freewheeling diode or flyback diode. It allows the stored energy in the reactor to safely dissipate, ensuring the circuit operates smoothly, and it protects the charged voltages of the capacitor from flowing back towards the DC supply. These two large capacitors are rated at 500 volts and have a capacity of 680 microfarads. These capacitors are commonly connected across the DC output to smooth out ripples and stabilize the DC voltage. In addition to ripple reduction, the capacitors also act as energy reservoirs. They store energy during the peak of the rectified AC cycle and supply it during low points, ensuring a steady voltage is delivered to the load. The compressor is connected in series with the collector and emitter. The compressor will receive power. The amount of current that flows will depend on the voltage across the compressor and its impedance. The positive side of the capacitor is directly connected to the IPM. This is how the system operates. Additionally, let me point something else out here. Notice the blue wire, which is the neutral side. Whenever you do the installation, ensure the neutral and phase connections are absolutely correct. Sometimes, if by mistake you reverse these connections, placing the phase on the neutral side and the neutral on the phase side, the system will still work, but only for a short time before it gets damaged. This is something you need to be very careful about. The next step I'll explain is how the SMPS, switched mode power supply system, works. However, I will cover this in my next video, where I will provide complete information. Click on the left or right thumbnail to watch our next videos, and subscribe. Thank you.